For you were once aliens yourselves in the land of Egypt.
For from you the word of the Lord has sounded forth.
I'm driving the car, I'm thinking of all kinds of things, but am I stopping to ask myself, why am I going to St. James this morning? As the gospel says today, the Sadducees had their turn last week to try to trap Jesus and were foiled. Now it's the Pharisees whose turn it is. And it was not unusual to ask this question. There are many laws, many prescriptions in Jewish law. In fact, there are over 600 of them. So that there should be a law or a prescription for every situation in life, which we know is impossible. I mean, we have infinite situations in life. We can't possibly have a law or a guideline for every single one, but nevertheless, there are those 600 and plus. And so it wasn't unusual to ask that question of a rabbi. In your estimation, what do you think is the most important law above all others? So that was a fair question. They weren't trying to trap him as the Sadducees were. The Jews were people for a long time, but there was a time when they were not a people as we understood them later. They were kind of a loose-knit people, if you will, who went to Egypt because they were starving back in their homeland. And as a result, they lived there and things went well, and afterwards things did not go well. There was a change in the administration, a different pharaoh. And suddenly he saw them no longer as citizens, but as aliens, and then as slaves. They could build his pyramids for him. And so their lives became intolerable, and something had to be done. And that's when God asked Moses to take this people and to free them and lead them to a land of freedom. And we know that's a long story, and I won't go into it this morning because we have a football game this evening. And we want you to get home in time for the football game. The fact of the matter is that God worked out a covenant with them. And as they journeyed through, say, 40 years in the desert, we don't know for sure, but it was in this crucible that they became a people through that covenant. It was a simple covenant. I will be your God, you will be my people. I will always be faithful to you, you must be faithful to me. Sounds simple, but from human experience, we know it isn't. So it was this then that was the centerpiece for forming them into a people. And they always went back to the notion of the covenant. And then God decided that he would give them something in addition to that. And this wasn't meant to be a burden, but it was meant to be a gift. And that is the gift of the law. It sounds strange, but the gift of the law. In other words, if you're going to be a covenantal people, here is what you must do. And we have these two tablets. On one side, first three commandments in relationship to God. The second side, seven commandments in relationship to one another. That's it. This is what you must do. So it really is not a burden or meant to be, but it is a gift. You be faithful to me as I am faithful to you. And so it is then. And so we have this, and the question then that was asked of our Lord is a very important question. We got all of these, which is the most important? And so he very wisely took two different places from Scripture, one saying that you must love the Lord with everything you got, mind, heart, spirit, everything you have. And then right after that, you have the love of neighbor. Love of neighbor as much as you love or we love ourselves. The two, as far as he was concerned, are inseparable. You can't have one without the other. Okay. And so we today live by that same law. It's no different. We are God's people. We are covenanted people, this time in the blood of Christ. So it's even more sacred than it was earlier on. We are a covenantal people. And I'm sure we try our best to live by that law. I think sometimes, though, we don't think about that. We just kind of go on in life as usual, many times living on the surface of life. And at times like today, our Lord calls us to try to get beyond or below that surface. They tell the story about a father who was a hardworking man, worked for his family, go to the office every day. And as he was going to the office with his briefcase, he walked past the living room, and there his three-year-old son was working with building blocks. He patted him on the head, left, and midway to the car, suddenly he stopped, and he got this terrible guilt feeling. What am I doing? What am I doing? So he turned around, walked into the house, threw his briefcase aside, sat down on the floor, and started playing blocks with the child. And the son turned to him and said, "Father, why are you angry with me? Why are you angry with me?" Now, the father wasn't angry with the child, but that's how the child interpreted it, because every day he'd do the same thing. He'd pat him on the head and go to work. And if you asked the father, he said, "Well, yeah, I love the child. That's why I go to work. I love the child." But he never articulated that. He didn't take time to somehow show that to the child, except to pat him on the head as he goes off to work. That's what I mean by kind of living on the surface of life. So you who are students, why do you go to school every day? You who work, why do you do that every day? You who are homemakers, why do you do that every day? Why am I here on Sundays? Most Sundays, why am I here? I got to ask myself that question. It's a routine. I'm driving the car, I'm thinking of all kinds of things, but am I stopping to ask myself, why am I going to St. James this morning? Why are you going to school? Why are you going to work? Why are you preparing a meal at home? The answer is simple. And I'm sure most of you would say, because I care for my family. Or because I care for the people of St. James. Or I go to school because I want to learn so that I can help other people. Or more simply put, I do it because I'm in love. I'm in love with my family. I'm in love with other people. I'm in love with the community here. That's why I do it. But you see, we don't take time to think about that. We just take it for granted. Now, I don't say that every day we must do this, although it would be nice if we would. We don't have to. But I think one thing would help if we did that. It would bring a certain quality, a certain effectiveness to our work that might not otherwise be there. I'm going to work harder at the office or at a machine or whatever it is because I'm doing something for other people. And they're rewarding me for that. And am I doing the very best or is it just going through the motions? Is that it? Same thing with the meal. I'm going to make a special meal this evening because I love the family. They're going to wonder why, and I'm not going to tell them. I'm just doing it because I love them. And the same it is with all of us, whatever it is we're doing. We can say we're doing out of love, but that in turn, I think, will add a certain flavor, if you will, a certain quality, a certain effectiveness that might not have been there before. We're not just going through the motions, I guess is what I'm saying. That's why this law of love is so important. Because it's the bottom line for everything, for everything. So if I love God, I'm going to obey him, not because I have to, not because I'm afraid I'm going to go to hell, not because I'm afraid God is going to punish me. That's not it at all. That's very poor motivation. I'm doing it because I'm in love with God. I know he's in love with me, and I'm going to respond because that's part of the covenant. I'm in love with God. And I'm going to do everything, mind, heart, spirit, soul, everything I can for him. And then the same for people, because they're images of God. I'm interested in the common good. And that's why we have that first reading today, because it goes back to the Old Testament and all those regulations we have. But what are the important ones? Our Lord is saying the people who are falling through the cracks, widows, orphans, and aliens in Old Testament times. Widows, orphans, and aliens. Widows, because if a woman lost her husband, that's it. She's in poverty. There's no social security. There's no social welfare. There's no social network. She's going to beg the rest of her life. The same thing with an orphan. That's all he's going to do is beg the rest of his life. And aliens, well, they're second, third class citizens and taken advantage of. And so our Lord takes those three people in the lowest rungs of society, or God does, and raises them up. And that's a barometer of how much we love, how much we're concerned about the people in the lowest rungs of our society. If we do well, great. If we do poorly, something's wrong. Something's wrong. And so we need a barometer like that today in terms of the members who are at the lowest rung of society. And so I go back to what I said before. You can't have one without the other. I can't say that I love God if I don't care for my brothers and sisters, or if I love them but I'm forgetful of God because they're images of God. So let's ask ourselves that question. What does this law of love mean to me? Do I realize I'm a covenanted person? Am I faithful to that covenant? Do I take some time to go beneath the surface and ask myself, why am I doing what I'm doing today? Like, why are we here today? Not because we commit a mortal sin if we don't come here today. We're here today because we want to be here today. We're here today to renew that covenant of love.